Hi, it's Mr. Andersen, and in this video, I'm going to talk about statistics for science. And the reason why statistics is important in science is that's what statistics is. It's basically collecting, organizing, analyzing, interpreting, and then presenting data so that people can use it. And so we don't usually do a lot of statistics in high school science, and that's too bad because it's very important that we understand what to do with data once we've collected it. And there's a big push right now to improve the statistics knowledge of high school students. And the reason why is that they become college students and they're eventually going to have to start working with what's called big data. And so, what is big data? Well, the days of a scientist just lonely sitting by themselves collecting data are gone. Most science now is done by huge teams or groups or centers, and a lot of it's crowdsourced, and we're generating so much data right now that we actually have to go through that. So, what's an example? Well, meteorology, or the study of weather and climate on our planet. We just get more and more data, better data, but we have to pour through this to make models and make predictions. Or genomics is sequencing of the genome, so looking at the actual letters in the nucleotides in DNA and RNA. And we sequence the human genome, but now we're sequencing all these different organisms, and so all that data is pouring in, and we have to look through it. Or this is a term I hadn't even heard of before, connectomics, which is basically using intense magnetic resonance imaging to look at neurons, looking at the brain, and then modeling that, using computers to model individual neurons and then grow that into like a virtual brain. So you can see over the next 20 or 30 years, we're going to need scientists who understand what to do with big data. And to understand big data, let's start by going through kind of the basics of statistics. And so when you're dealing with statistics, one big thing when we're talking broad is the idea of what a population is. And so a population is big. And so a population is going to be everything. So it could be like all the students in a class. So that could be a population, but it can get much bigger than that. And so when we're studying the population, not to be confused with like a population that we study in ecology, the population, all of the characteristics of that are going to be called parameters. And so an example of one that we'll actually use in science is N. That's the population size. But I said that the population is everything. And so it could also be like all the stars in the universe, or it could be all the planets in the universe, or it could be not only one scientific experiment, but an infinite number of scientific experiments that you could do. And so it really is everything when we're talking about the population. And so if we go back to an example of a population, well, in science what we can do is we can take a sample of that. And so if this is the population, then this is a sample of the population. And we move from population, where we study parameters, and we get to the sample, we have what are called statistics. And so statistics are going to be characteristics of a sample. And hopefully that's a random sample. And so a really good question at this point might be is, which is more important? Is the population important or is the sample important? In other words, which one do we use more? And I used to think, the population has to be the most important thing. We want to know everything. We want to know all the outcomes, or we want to know what the universe looks like. And in fact, it's the wrong answer. The right answer and the most important thing is the sample. Because you can never know everything, but you can know a sample of that. And if you have a good understanding of the statistics, we can make predictions about everything, predictions about the population. And so everything I'm going to talk about, I'm talking about the sample, because that's what scientists do. We can't do every conceivable experiment. We can't gather every conceivable piece of data. We just have to work with what's called the sample and make sense of that. And so let me give you an example of this. This right here is I remember reading there was a survey, and they asked scientists, like, what's the greatest scientific discovery of the last 100 years? So from 1900 to 2000. And I thought maybe it's going to be Einstein, relativity, or quantum physics, or all of those things. Actually, the right answer, or the winner, we'll say, was this guy. His name is Edwin Hubble. And you've probably heard of his name because they named the Hubble Space Telescope after him, but you might not know what he did. And so he sat here at the Mount Wilson Observatory and he looked at galaxies in the universe. And what he found is that no matter where he looked in the universe, They seem to be shifted towards the red, so they were more red in color. What does that tell us? Well, as objects move away from us, they get red shifted, and so it told him that all of these galaxies were moving away from us. In other words, everything in the universe is moving away. And you can see that he just plotted that in a nice little scatter plot, and then we have a line of fit. And so did he measure all of the galaxies in the universe? No, but he had a sample set of those. And from that, we can make predictions. And what's the prediction that we make based on this? It's the idea of an expanding universe, and the idea that all, since everything is expanding, that means everything was together at one point. And so this is that Big Bang theory, that idea that all of the universe began at one singularity. And so let's get to some statistics. Let's actually get to some numbers of the sample. And so let's go through these. First one's going to be the sample size. That's going to be the number of observations that you make. And so that could be the number in your sample group, in your random sample. Next, we have what's called the X bar, or the mean. The mean and the average are going to be the exact same thing. So if you know what an average is and how to figure it out, that's going to be the mean. Next is the median. Median is simply going to be the midpoint in between all of our data sets. And then finally, we have a range. And so this is a sample set over here. So let's say in the science lab, this is some data that you collect. And so could you figure out these four things: sample size, median, mean, and range? Well, let me walk you through it. So the first thing we could do is the sample size. And so sample size, or N, get used to that letter N right here. Sample size is just going to be the number of samples that we made. And so in this set, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And so our N value is going to be 7. Let's go to the next one. What's the mean, or what's the average? Well, to figure that out, all you do is add up all of these quantities, and you're going to divide it by the number of quantities. And so if I add all these up together, I get 35. If I divide that by 7, which is the total number of in my sample size, I'm going to get a mean or an average of 5. How do you do the median, or how do you find the midpoint? Well, you have to line them up in order. And so when I line it up in order, basically what I can do is I can cross it out from the side. So I'll cross one out from the sides, I'll cross another one out from the side, and then we have the midpoint, which is right here. So the median and the mean in this case is going to equal 5. But you might think to yourself, well, what do I do if it's not even, or if it is even? In other words, what do I do here? Well, I could knock off 2 from each side, and let me knock off another one from each side, and now I have 5 and 6. So if this is our sample set, then our median is going to be the average between 5 and 6. So our average is going to be 5.5. Let's get to the range then. What's the range? The range is going to be the difference between the extremes. And so if this is a number 2 and this is the number 13, so this is my low and this is my high, then my range is simply going to be 11 in this case. And so what are these? These are all simple statistics that we can gather from a sample set. And again, it's a random sample from everything, from this big population. Last thing I want to leave you with is an idea that sometimes is confusing to students, and that's called degrees of freedom. And we refer to that as N minus 1. And so what is N? Well, N, remember, is going to be the sample size. And where does the freedom come from? Well, I drew a flag right here to help you remember that. So what does that mean? What is a degree of freedom? Well, think of it like this. This is the best way to understand it. So imagine I have these three numbers, and they're going to add up to 10. And so this is A plus B plus C equals 10. And I say, choose a random number. And let's make it easy by just choosing a whole number. Well, you might say that this is 3. So I'm going to choose this to be 3. And you notice that I had total freedom. I had a freedom in my choice as to what number I was going to choose to represent A. I had total freedom here. Well, that was fun. Let me get a little more freedom. So let's say I'm going to choose the next number, B. I want to go crazy. Maybe I want the next one to be 13. I could choose any number in the world. In other words, I have freedom to choose what that is. And so now this is fun. I have a lot of freedom. So let's go to the last one then. So we're going to say that this plus this plus this equals 10. So I've got a constraint here. It's got to equal 10. Well, now we got to choose C. Well, what can C be? Well, I've all of a sudden lost my freedom here. In other words, if this is 3, this is 13, this has to be negative 6 if I want this to be 10, because this is 16 minus 6, that's got to be 10. And so all of a sudden, I lost my freedom. And so when we're talking about degrees of freedom, how do you figure that out? Well, you take the number in your data set. In this case, it's going to be 3, and you're going to subtract 1 from that. And so in this case, I had 2 degrees of freedom, or there were 2 numbers at which I had a choice as to what I was going to choose. And so this will be important in a couple of different ways. Number one, when we're figuring out standard deviation using n minus 1 or degrees of freedom, we're going to get more accurate results or more precise results. And so you'll see this again when we calculate standard deviation. And then when we start comparing data sets, so when we do a chi-squared test, it's important that you understand what a degree of freedom is. So if we have 2 different groups, then we'd only have 1 degree of freedom. Or if we have 8 different groups or 8 different choices, then we have 7 degrees of freedom. And so those are all statistics. Again, they're parts of the sample set, which is part of everything. And it allows us to give meaning to math. And what I mean by, I learned so much math in high school, especially in Algebra 2, but I didn't always know, like, when am I going to use this? Statistics is something I promise you that you are going to use. If you move on to college and hopefully, you know, get some kind of an advanced degree or find an awesome job, statistics will come back and it will find you at some point. So you might as well learn it now. So this is an intro on statistics, and I hope that was helpful.